Okay, so I think we're pretty much ready to go. I'm just going to give a quick introduction to how the webinar works. If people have any questions, you can use the Q&A button to post questions during the session. We'll be taking questions at the end. You can also use the raise your hand if you would like to ask a question. And when we get to the questions section, I will unmute you if you'd like to say that question. So really delighted to have you with us, Russell, and I'm sure a lot of the business community are really excited to hear what you've got to say about how things are going at the council. So over to you.
Okay, thank you. And thank you very much for the invitation to take part in this this afternoon. And unusually, like many of you, I'm working from home and have been working from home for the last 6 to 8 weeks. And if you're not aware, I'm the chief executive who the last 2 months have been the most challenging time of my career in many ways. And I suspect in many ways it's only going to get more difficult as we move forward. My professional background is that I'm a town planner and I do manage the council's economic development team supporting business as well. And I just want to pause and think about COVID and coronavirus for a minute or so. We, like many organisations, tend to learn what is going on by the Prime Minister's statement or indeed by the press conference from Downing Street late every afternoon. And we're responding to that. And to start with, like many, the response was, broadly speaking, how could we sensibly close down quite a lot of services we run, particularly services we run from within buildings, so closing swimming pools, the town hall, etc., etc. But equally, we've had many of our services who are busier than ever before. Those that support vulnerable people, those that deal with various types of benefit claims, those that support businesses via giving out business grants, which I'll come back to in a bit. In the last 10 days, probably the focus has switched a little bit to how do we support getting back to whatever normal becomes. And probably, as can arguably be seen by some of the issues that have been raised in the media this week, that recovery process is less clear-cut, less certain, more phased, and will create a different array of challenges than normal. So, you know, just in a small level, you know, overnight, we've taken the decision to reopen things such as sports that we own and manage off the back of government advice. Last week, and it started yesterday, we've decided to restart our garden waste collection services from throughout town. And as we move forward, we've got a whole series of additional we need to work with our partners to. So the announcement on Sunday, and particularly the detail that came out on Monday, provided some degree of hope and or expectation that shops and related services may be able to reopen closed from the 1st of June. But how do we then successfully manage with our partners more people coming in both to work and to visit for various reasons the town centre? And how do we provide people with confidence they would want to do that? So I don't have much by way of advice to give, but equally, if you haven't read it yet, I would recommend reading some of the COVID secure documentation, which can be found on the government websites, particularly the Business and Industrial Strategy Department, about how businesses can get from the council's perspective. Two quick observations. One, we are issuing out something like £24 million worth of business grants at the moment. We've given out nearly £21 million now, and we're still looking, if that's the right phrase, for around 380 businesses to apply who we believe are eligible for those grants. And the grants are available to smaller businesses with rateable values, and particularly slightly larger businesses in retail, leisure and hospitality sectors. It's not a loan. It is a grant. And equally, you can still apply for it and you're still eligible for it, even if you've been operating during the last 6 weeks. And then my final point is, if you want a summary of what the council is doing at any point in time and more contact details on what we're doing in the business space, we publish a weekly statement every Friday morning, which can be accessed from the top part of our main ipswich.co.uk web page, and provides hopefully a series of useful bits of information. And that inevitably, not even the 10 minutes I said it might take, is probably what I wanted to say, but I'm more than happy to take any questions on, within reason, any topic. So, thank you, Ruth.
Thank you, Russell. That was great. So I don't see any questions in the Q&A at the moment, but if anyone would like to ask a question or speak to Russell about anything, you can raise your hand in the webinar and then I can allow you to talk and you can post your question to Russell. So do let me know if you would like to ask anything. Does anybody have a pressing question?
Looking at some of the names of the participants, there's two or three who aren't backward in coming forward normally.
Yes, indeed. So what do you think are some of the challenges that businesses are going to face, Russell, when they do start to go back? I know we've had some people in our hallway chat talking about some people being really keen to get back, others being a bit hesitant. How do you think businesses
manage that? Just use my own experience of being the boss of an office building, if I simplify it to that. So one morning we told roughly 500 people to go home and work from home for the foreseeable future, and that was more than twice our previous biggest home working day, which was kind of the last time we had a decent amount of snow. We got to kind of 200, so 500 work from home. The numbers went straight down to less than 50 in the building. They're now less than 30 in the building on every day. And for those that don't know the building, that's three floors of 12,000 square foot feet. I do go in once or twice a week because we have a sort of management rota, and I'm then normally the only person at work in a desk environment of 60 desks. So we've got a degree of comfort from working from home, and we're not looking to switch that off at any point soon. And I think that is true of many major employers where staff have successfully worked from home. So that will create some challenges, and indeed the national message is to continue to work from home where you can. So we're not looking to go back, but equally there will be different views within staff. So we've done a staff survey, and some are missing the social interaction and, paraphrasing, chomping at the bits to get back. Others would quite happily work from home for the foreseeable future with no definition as to what foreseeable means. So there's kind of that individual basis. Then I think there's the basis of do people want individuals in their homes? So, one example we've got is we stopped most of our tradespeople going into council houses, which was done from a staff safety perspective primarily, unless it was really worked. But now we're getting some of those tensions as to whether people would want people going back into their homes. I'm sure the same will be true in the market, which can now get back up and running. And then we've got the whole issue of how we restart, let's just call it town centres. So we're working with Ipswich Central and some partners on how we can sensibly manage stuff getting to that 1st of June date. Yeah. And that's without the hospitality industry. So whilst there are shows that you could book at the Regent in the autumn, exactly where things such as theatres will be throughout the rest of the year, bluntly, probably as good as mine, and we'll probably most of us be wrong at this point in time.
I mean, we've got a couple of questions which are on the same kind of theme. It's about businesses that have not yet claimed the grant. And the questions are, is the council doing anything to proactively contact them with a view to making a claim?
So two parts to this. Yes is the basic. So we have a list of, I can't remember the exact number, 2,000 businesses, and we've paid out to around 1,700. There are, let's just simplify, 400 left that we believe could well be eligible. So we've now written to all those 400 twice. We've tried where we can find contact details, i.e. phone and email, to get hold of them, and we're using some of our partners such as Ipswich to help with that. I'm advised for data protection reasons, it's, and indeed for fraud potential reasons, it's not appropriate, if I be excited, for me to publish a list of who we think are in the paper, say, but there's plenty of information, again, via the link I've talked about on our website for that. And there's quite a chance that some of that 400 aren't actually eligible because state aid does apply. So if somebody has 100 premises around the country, they can only claim for a certain number of those up to a certain level. Some of the, let's call it multinational, multiple outlet retailers we've got on the list, but probably they're not eligible. But that's unlikely, realistically, to apply to his members. But it does require a rateable value. We are about to get a smaller pot of money, probably between $1 million and $1.5 million at some point in the next quarter or two from government, but we'll have greater discretion as to how to give out. But I need to be fairly coy about that for the moment, for the simple reason that we're still awaiting the government guidance as to what types of businesses are appropriate. Is likely to include potentially some ISBA members who, for sake of argument, don't have a rateable value as the business because the kind of rates is rolled within the rent that they might pay to their landlord or to their shared office. Uh-huh. We are awaiting the guidance from government before we can see anything in any form. Because what I don't want to do is announce something and then find that out of the rules.
Yeah, I think this is probably a related question. Do you know how many, the number of buildings that are involved in that?
So bearing in mind they are all different rateable premises, it won't necessarily be 400, but are different buildings, different rateable size rather than sort of a shared office space in the original. So it's probably in the high 300.
In the high 300s,
which about half of which are in the town.
And a follow-up is how many buildings could one company claim for?
So the detail, I believe, can be accessed from my business team, but it's less about buildings per se. It's more about people's state aid position, which largely is about the amount of money you've received via various public sources. Point.
Okay.
So at the moment, an answer to Mr. Gladding's question, just to leap around slightly, which is there a deadline effectively? So the current answer to that is no, there isn't a deadline. The government publish, which is a delight, on a weekly basis, every council, all 314 of them in the country, as how they're doing on this object. And realistically, we hit the blocks very quickly and gave out a lot of money very quickly and are now struggling to get the remains to apply. So we don't have a backlog. The government haven't said there's a deadline. I won't be setting one. But at some point, inevitably, we are going to have to return something by way of final position to the government.
So there's another question. We have three nurseries under Ipswich Borough, which we pay rates. Could we claim on those three buildings?
I believe the basic answer is yes, but there are only certain types of quality depending on the rate value and the precise nature of nurseries, which tend not to be in the retail, leisure and hospitality sector. So if you're not entitled to small business rate relief, then I suspect you might not qualify. But the email address for how to inquire on these things is within that statement. And I think my business rate.
Yeah, we can share the link as well. When I upload the recording, we can add some information in the text. So we can also add that detail if anyone needs that after the session.
I will be able to find it. Look at my screen now in a.
Yeah, so one from James. What changes are likely to be made to transport infrastructure in the borough?
Right, so I'm always slightly wary about talking about transport because that's mainly a county council function rather than anything to do with the borough council. But it's never stopped me talking about transport, so I will just walk for a minute or two. So it's quite an interesting challenge that people have at this point in time. So patronage of public transport is at an all-time low. Use of car parks is at an all-time low. And how that is going to get back to anything like normality will be interesting. There are, I might argue, slightly mixed messages about it. Quite a lot of messaging out there that is about you can walk and cycle, please do so. More than you might have done previously, which is all very laudable, but not necessarily for people. And equally, the government has introduced some flexibilities and announced some funding, although none of it's flowed locally yet, as to how road space might be able to be reallocated to facilitate more cyclists and more pedestrians. And it's not just necessarily more cyclists. Some of it is providing space to ensure social work even without an increase in number of pedestrians. Equally, at the same time, there is some advice that bluntly it's better to drive somewhere than it is to So, you know, it's a bit of an unknown at the moment. The county have started to do, and indeed some work on it already, some work as to how they might respond to the guidance that was issued on the front. I think it wasn't as one example. They have closed a section of the quayside at the waterfront between, I think it's the Custom House and Coprolite Street, to ensure that pedestrians and cyclists can walk down that bit of roadway that runs outside Salt House and Isaac without the fear of being run over by cars coming behind them or getting too near other people. Then James has asked a question about park and ride. I suspect from two perspectives. So perspective one, and I'm really pleased we were successful in getting a local testing station to the Ipswich area, but observing that the testing station is the park and ride cop dock, which is testing around, I think, 1,000 people a day at the moment. Great that locals don't have to travel any significant distance to get somewhere. I'm not entirely sure what that means for the park and ride use of that site. Clearly in the short term there isn't use of park and ride, but there wasn't anyway. So I might have to come back and clarify that later, but certainly there is nothing to suggest that the county council or First Bus, who run the park and ride services, are looking to downplay their commitment to park and ride as a means of travel over time. Well, I think I've exhausted the questions that I can't see. I don't think I need to answer James's one that the catwalk was on, so that's
Yeah, I just wanted to say that there's a comment from Peter that says Ipswich Borough Council have been very quick and good with dealing with claims compared to some other councils. And I think that I've heard that from other businesses as well, that it's been a very positive experience. So please do pass that on to the relevant people.
And we've picked that up from Number. And I know the team who are working very hard on this have been very grateful for the comments received. And Frustrated is the wrong word. And now finding it a bit frustrating that you can't give out the remaining 4 million because we're struggling to get people to engage with us. But hey ho.
Yeah. So if we have any other questions, do feel free to drop them in the Q&A. James says he agrees with Peter's comment. So great. Otherwise, if there's no further questions.
Just one final point, if I can, Ruth. If anybody does think of something that they'd like to ask or do it a different way, was for whatever reason too shy or couldn't get the technology to work or whatever to ask, then my email address is no great secret. It's russell.williams@ipswich.gov.uk. I'm more than happy to receive stuff, and I will ensure you get a reply either direct from me if I do know the answer, or from others at appropriate and timely manner.
Yeah, that'd be great to know. Thank you, Russell. And we really appreciate you taking some time to speak directly with the business community today. So
it's kind of the highlight of my day so far, but I won't tell you what else I've done. About 5 hours ago.
Oh, wonderful. Okay, well, yes, thanks very much, Russell. Okay. And we will record this and put the recording up shortly if people haven't had a chance to listen to it live. So, yeah, hope you enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you. Bye all.
Thank you very much. Bye, everybody.